down to the manger, see the little stranger wrapped in swaddling, below the Prince of Peace. The wheels start turning, torches start burning, and behold, wise men journey from the east. How a little baby boy bring the people so much joy. Son of a carpenter, Mary carried the light. This must be Christmas, must be tonight. Shepherd on the hillside, where over my flock I abide. On a cold winter night, a band of angels sing. In a dream I heard a voice say, fear not, come rejoice. It's the end of the beginning, praise the newborn King. How a little baby boy bring the people so much joy. Son of a carpenter, Mary carried the light. This must be Christmas, must be tonight. Saw it with my own eyes, written up in the sky. Why a simple herdsman such as I? And then it came to pass, he was born at last, right below the star that shines on high. How a little baby boy bring the people so much joy. Son of a carpenter, Mary carried the light. This must be Christmas, must be tonight. Son of a carpenter, Mary carried the light. This must be Christmas, must be tonight.
State, in a police state, you don't care about the social sciences. What does sociology concern itself
with? Well, you do care about
community, people relating to each other. In a police state, you don't want that. You want everybody separate.
Right.
So look at all our community institutions that are going under. Public libraries. You can't have a democracy without public libraries.
You know why they're going under? Because they're the logical place to have Wi-Fi. If you have strong broadband access, public access is the greatest security to a community.
That's one of the reasons. Libraries are a place where the cast-offs go so that they won't be hassled by people who have money. You know, you can be poor and live in a shelter, and it'll make you crazy living in a shelter.
Sure.
So
right.
You can go to a library, you can read, you can relax. You can be with people who don't put you down. Children, we used to call them latchkey children. They can go to a library after school. I mean, it is an incredible public community service librarians give us.
Right.
Not to mention the students whose college universities shut down after midnight, all right? But they still have to study, and they want access to certain databases, all right? But now they're no longer in college. They couldn't afford to pay for that next term. They can go to the library and they can access a lot of those databases for free. It's a real loss. And, of course, the public school system. And then it goes on and on. What about the institutions that we don't necessarily see as public, like WBAI? And what has happened to that voice? We all see what happened to public radio. Public radio. It became a voice for the corporations, mm-hmm. and now this is the way they want BAI to go. We have lost our voice.
That's the way public access television is going.
That's the way public access television is going.
This very station that we're in here now used to be completely public access.
Thank you.
Now commercial people come in here and rent this studio.
Making it hard for us to get time.
Making it harder for the public access producers. It means more producers have to fight over less time.
Yes.
And I like what you said when you said you were in California and there were these people who were listening to this, looking at this documentary from our decade.
Yeah.
And the concept that symbolizes the 60s more than anything else is being open to something new, to a different possibility for life on this planet. You know, what was the hippies thing? Chill, relax.
Yeah.
That's not what they meant. What they meant was don't get uptight over somebody who's different from you,
right.
or somebody who thinks different from you. You know, be easy. It's this
not
generation's
only don't
word.
Be uptight about it, welcome them to give you a much greater perspective
exactly.
on what's really happening.
Exactly.
And when you know the truth, everybody goes faster and faster to the truth because it's true.
Ralph Poynter and Lynne Stewart created with a group of teachers in New York, an organization called the Teachers Freedom Party. Mm-hmm. And this was one of the vehicles. It was an organization of people of goodwill. And they came from all political points of view. There were liberals, whatever that is.
Yeah.
There were communists. There were socialists, whatever that is. And there were just black nationalists like me. We came in there. It wasn't just people spouting forth what they believed. They did that too. But they always backed it up by citing a source where they got the information. It was like a university for a person of the 60s who wanted to understand what it was that was making them so angry and making them want to fight back. And it analyzed. All the time they analyzed, they discussed, they talked, debate, and fought with each other. But it was fair fighting. They didn't fight with you and call you names. They fought with you and said, well, why don't you read that if you don't believe me? That was the name they called you. The name they called you was, well, then why don't you read? Okay? There are so few organizations like that now. How do I know? Because I still go to a lot of different meetings of a lot of different groups. People are not open to reading. They don't want to do their homework.
That is the interesting thing. And as Frederick Douglass said, slavery is incompatible with education,
mm-hmm.
and everybody knows it. And so there is a shutdown, a dummying down of our society. You'd be surprised, and I don't know if you would be surprised as to what people do not know, do not understand, and they no longer care that they do not know and they
and
do not understand.
Back to when you were talking about the stadium.
Yes.
Part of the reason that the government is doing the stadium is because if everybody's watching football and baseball, they're not paying attention to politics. They're not looking at the hospitals that they're losing.
Thank you.
They're not losing all these things.
Right.
That started all the way back in Rome.
Mm-hmm.
The Roman emperor, they were stealing, the wealthy were stealing all the money in Rome. They were afraid that the people would rise up mm-hmm. because of the poverty, so they built that giant stadium
mm-hmm.
and they had gladiators killing each other
mm-hmm.
to entertain the people and to keep their minds off it while all the wealth of Rome was stolen and they threw them bread.
And if you don't think that the young men who are involved in our sports are gladiators, just look at the recent settlement of the NFL with their players whose brains have been and bodies have been rattled and racked. They gave them, and this is what I fault the NFL union, you're talking about union sold out, they gave them peanuts, chump change. These young men whose brains have been destroyed by concussion after concussion.
And you better believe law firms were trading lots of dollars under the table.
Oh, yes.
I mean, one thing about me being self-taught in what's going on in my apartment in Gramercy Park is that it's so evident from my paperwork. It's been filed since 2010. You can see me figuring it out by myself. My paperwork starts very primitive, and it starts to go faster and faster. And like I say, you know, framing the Black Panthers.
Where did you go for that information, may I ask, as you developed your enlightenment?
Well, on the internet.
Exactly.
It was on foreclosure. I started to notice. First of all, I did a documentary on low-level radioactive stones. And when I was working with these radioactive stones, I noticed I wasn't needing my reading glasses anymore. Well, I was very impressed that I, because I'd been doing great, you know, the Bates method for better eyesight, and but nothing ever affected it like these radioactive stones. So from that documentary, I posted it on the internet, and I had one healer who worked with a lady who had breast cancer so bad that you could smell it when you came into the house. So it wasn't that she didn't have cancer. She got a very radioactive rock and put it on this bloody, drippy breast cancer, and it healed rather quickly. So I posted this, and then viewers, at this time, even though I wasn't making any money from posting on the internet, on YouTube, I had my own, you know, research and development team, because YouTube was giving me probably traffic they stole from people before. Now I realize that, you know, what goes around comes around. Now that I'm being ripped off, I can see it. But at the beginning, it was great. I was getting all this attention, 5 million hits on YouTube. So they came back and they said, there's something even more compelling than radioactive stones, and that was the essential oil of marijuana. Well, I had been completely against marijuana and drugs because I was doing long mantras and things, and I thought that was bad. So I looked at these patents, and I saw
patents
on medical, on marijuana. There's 9 patents, but the one that I saw was called Cannabinoids as Neuroprotectants, written by a now deceased Nobel Prize winner, talking about the oil. And when you smoke it, you destroy the medicine. So it took me 2 years to find the oil. Alan Steinfeld was my boyfriend at the time, and I said, please, you know, there was a few people I thought that he knew that, you know, and in the back of his mind, he kind of wanted to do it, but everybody sort of stays away. If you're sort of a new ager, you don't do drugs, you know. So he didn't have that connection, but I, you know, more and more evidence was coming in. I wanted to see this. And then I met Joe. And I fell in love with Joe and his son as they were arguing in front of the judge, because like you say, truth, when truth is coming out, it's exciting, you know, when real justice starts to happen. And Joe would be answering back to the judge, and I thought, wow, this is incredible. So as I got to know Joe better and his case, he got on the internet in 2008. Now, I feel very certain that they spied on him through the internet, and they were giving all these sheriff's departments all the new gadgets and stuff, and so they thought, great, we found the guy, they've got 300 plants and so on, but you've still got the problem of the search warrant. Who have they harmed? So they said that on an anonymous tip they came in. Well, that's wrong. Like if Lynn came from a police family, I actually learned a lot from a man who was taught by policemen, and he said every arrest is a citizen's arrest. You have to have somebody who has been violated to sign the complaint. The police are supposed to have a signature. So if anything goes wrong with the arrest, the onus goes back and the responsibility on whoever signed it. That's why a judge's signature on the warrant is so important. So when you ask how I learned what I did about the foreclosure fraud and the banking fraud, is I knew it was very strange that my board changed my locks in 2004 when I was in India. But I was waiting to get back in the bucks to where I could hire lawyers so I could go after them, because this offended me. It was my ego that was hurt. Why were my locks changed? Well, by the time I filed a lawsuit through the help of a friend, because I never got back in the bucks, he filed a boilerplate template key lock change for $2 million remedy. And it was immediately accepted because you have to give food to these law firms to keep them in business. So they need lawsuits, and mine was a no-brainer. Probably had I gone through in the way they'd expected, I would have wound up with maybe $50 and the law firms would have exchanged the $2 million. Mm-hmm. Because after filing it, I started getting in the mail insurance companies saying that all the insurance was off. So that means that the right to privacy...
Insurance companies from the
board building. Or whatever. Mm-hmm. In other words, you have to carry insurance against being sued. But the insurance is off if you violate rights. So I knew the right to privacy was important, but I still couldn't quite understand how. So when we were working through Joe's case, because at the beginning Joe got a computer and remembered some discussions he had with a man called, what was the guy's name? The 13th Amendment, missing 13th Amendment guy.
Oh, David Dodge.
David Dodge was doing research on the missing 13th Amendment, and he went up to old libraries in Maine and Vermont.
Libraries again, yes.
Yeah. And he discovered that we had a 13th Amendment that said judges should not come from a privileged class, that you should be tried by your peers. No lawyer class. And this amendment had been passed, but eventually they went to all the libraries and buried the evidence about the real 13th Amendment.
Right.
And subsequently the 14th Amendment that you think freed the slaves actually enslaved everybody. Mm. But that's a whole other discussion.
Yes.
So with the pot thing, I said to Joe, there's things here that are so similar to foreclosure, because I started listening to foreclosure people on the internet.
The
and again, it was black voices that were so savvy, so sharp, picking up the swindle that I wasn't seeing. And I think most white people wouldn't see, because like Joe said, again, when you've been beat by somebody, you learn those moves so you can block it the next time the move comes.
Yes.
But if you're white and you haven't been in any of this, and you've also been profoundly miseducated. Mm-hmm. In other words, they miseducate black people, but they miseducate white people.
Exactly.
Just
everybody,
in different ways.
In different,
yes.
They spin it in a different way so you don't see it. That's why I'm saying Theater 80 for the Lynne Stewart event in May, getting this DVD. I didn't even have the full money for the DVD. I think it was $10. I only had 7 or 8. And the guy, he looked at me and he decided it was worth it to let go of it for 7 or 8. So I took that DVD home, framing the Black Panthers. I said, you know, I've always really wanted to know
what happened,
what was really going on.
Exactly.
Because I was from Berkeley.
Yes.
This started to happen in Oakland.
Right.
But I went to a girls' school where I changed buses and I'm in my uniform. And I didn't have a breath of a chance to figure out what happened. Maybe on Telegraph Avenue, you'd see in a record store, maybe a little display where you'd see some of the real characters. But, you know, you're a kid. You don't really have that much time, or you're not really encouraged. I knew public access was important. I knew the zip code was evil, but I didn't quite understand why. I mean, in Berkeley, they spin things differently, just like the person who didn't know Lynn's husband was black and was kind of shocked that she didn't know it. Just because she prided herself on being
informed.
A Berkeley progressive.
Yes.
How could she have not known this?
Right.
You know?
So it was the connection between your rights as a tenant and then the medical thing.
Well, see, I wasn't a tenant. I was an owner.
Okay.
So then when Joe looked at the contract, he said, you know, when you make a, because Joe's a dealer, right? You make a deal. You have to be honorable. Mm-hmm. You have to go, you have this, I have this. You know, particularly if you get something in writing, he said, you can go through any contract and you change what you don't like. You initial it and then you sign it. So it became very evident that the proprietary lease is an unconscionable contract. But since the key was changed, the lock was changed, that means instantly it became null and void. But it took me years to figure this out. Like I say, I'm self-taught. But because when you're self-taught, you can't be swindled, because you pulled yourself up from your own bootstraps. You see what's going on. It's a swindle.
This takes us back to Frederick Douglass again on learning how to read in white. And one of the things he said is education and slavery are incompatible.
Completely.
Totally incompatible.
Yeah. Well,
this is why they don't want a public school system. This is why they don't want libraries. This is why they don't want WBAI.
The country has progressed or regressed to the state of there is no law. It is irrelevant.
Right.
And
right.
That's,
and one of the things that kind
as you try, you and Lynn always tell me, for people like me, there never was law.
That's right.
That's why Trayvon Martin is not a surprise. What is a surprise is that this so-called hip generation, we in the 60s would have solved their hash in 2 seconds. We would have boycotted everything, Florida. We would have shut the country down economically. And these little modern day, all I got to say about this youth right now, you're a bunch of chumps. You can't even give up Tropicana juice.
Yeah.
For 2 weeks. I mean,
but they're on their little iPhones, and these little iPhones through, I call it IP address discrimination. Mm-hmm. It's worse than sexual discrimination,
yes,
than race discrimination,
yes,
than religious discrimination,
yes,
because it means each IP address, they can mm-hmm. determine what that little thing gets and what mm-hmm. it doesn't get. Mm-hmm. And they can start to put you in chat rooms so that you think. I mean,
that's
I don't know who I'm. If I'm going out on analog, we're going out on analog right now. It's
right.
harder to create back doors and so on with analog, although mm-hmm. it has been done. I know it because I've talked to people
right.
in master control from years back.
Mm-hmm.
So there are dirty things that are done
mm-hmm.
to keep the public from having access to knowledge.
Right.
But nothing like the precision of the IP address discrimination. However,
yes.
however, if you know law, if they can look at you, you can just as easily look right back at them,
mm-hmm.
and you can pin them, and you can find the exact IP address that violated your rights. Now, one man told me about this in Berkeley.
This is what makes WikiLeaks and Julian Assange so dangerous, and why they had to go after him the way they did.
Well, but you know, but
mm-hmm.
but go for IP address and hacking, because one guy told me in Berkeley that the Air Force was coming in and looking at him. He said the whole country of China was looking at him. He thought, what's so interesting that they're looking at me? But because he's an expert at this, he knew they were looking.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when the Air Force from somewhere in Northern California were looking at him, he could pin the exact IP address. They fired that guy, but then Joe...
I said that he was probably working for the Air Force, and they just told him, oh, we fired him because he got caught. But they just moved him and said, don't go there no more. I don't think they really fired him.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah.
one of the points I like to make about what she's saying is, right now, they got all these kids with this thing. They can now say, keep these kids to only certain knowledge. If they try to access something, they can reroute them to someplace else.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And they can, you know, these little boxes that these kids got, I think, is one of the most dangerous things happening to this country.
Unless you educate them.
Unless you educate
well,
them.
Well, you see, the interesting thing is, more dangerous than that is people not aware of what they don't know and people not wanting to find out what they don't know.
Right.
And this is where
they
we
can
are.
Keep people, they can keep people yes. from finding out what
before,
they want to know.
Before that, you see, as long as people are searching for information, everything is okay. But when people are more interested in who sings what the best on any given night, then we are had.
Right, right.
And so
right.
my daughter used to say to me, Dad, what are you worried about the young people? She says, they're not coming to your meeting tonight. And I'm saying, well, how do you know? And she said, because they're watching who can sing the best tonight. This is a big night. And I'd say, oh, and I don't want it to be true.
American Idol.
Whatever
Idol,
it was.
Yeah.
And so she says, you know, you're going to be there. If that's what your aim is, you better pick another night for this particular meeting.
Mm-hmm.
No, and then she says, even if you pick another night, they're going to be afraid to come to your meeting because you have a history, and what they have learned is Ralph is bad.
Mm.
The government is good, and if you associate with him, even if you can sing the best on any given night, you're not going to get a chance because you'll be labeled as one of those people.
Wow.
And I say, you know, I kind of get disgusted with it. And I'm saying, you know, there's more truth to that than, you know,
But as you're talking about there is no law, if there were law, there is no way the insurance companies would be able to dip their straw into our health benefits the way they do. They serve no purpose.
They really don't.
Absolutely no purpose.
That's another third-party swindle.
But they can no longer steal from abroad the way they used to. They're being kicked out of countries all over the world as people all over the world take their countries back. So now they're coming here, and I have to say, Ralph and Lynn were one of the first people I heard say this. When those who are running the world, the corporations, lose their constituencies abroad in countries that develop enough strength to kick America's control out of their government, then they're going to come here and try to enslave us. And when you look at what's happening with our health system, or what's laughingly called a health system, a small country like Guyana has single-payer health care, and we can't get it? This is absurd. There's only one reason why we can't get it, and that's because of corruption and the lack of morality in this nation state.
That's why they give licenses to practice medicine, because mm-hmm. the doctors really don't know how to heal. They mm-hmm. know how to kiss the ass of the insurance people. I've mm-hmm. watched it in the nursing homes. Mm-hmm. It's disgusting. Mm-hmm. If you really want to heal, and I told this to foreclosure experts that came to my place, you know, they were shaking me and trying to scare me and mm-hmm. stuff, and I was talking to them, and one of them, cancer did come up, and all of a sudden, in the middle of talking about, you know, what would I do if they foreclose on me, I said, okay, I'm going to have cameras here. When they kick in the door, I'm going to get the faces of all those people, because it's all unlawful. I know it was. And right in the middle of talking about this, because the younger guy who was probably brought there as a witness, because, you know, we're talking about fraud.
Yes.
So when you're talking about fraud, nothing's going to be in writing. Mm-hmm. They can't send anything through the mail. But I thank them for coming and talking to me, because I always like to talk to people. But in the middle, to the young guy, I said, when it comes to healing cancer, you've got to have a lion of a doctor. You've got to have an advocate, somebody that's going to go in there and balance you out. Because law is natural. Law, you know, you drop an apple, it falls. It's the law of gravity. Mm-hmm. You know, ignorance of the law is no excuse. So if you're seeking remedy in the courts, it goes same with curing the human body. And so if you are off balance, something's wrong, you go to somebody like you know, someone would go to Lynn, because she's an expert in her field. The person who needs her help doesn't have the time to study everything
exactly.
She's studied. Mm-hmm. So same thing with cancer and all these other diseases. We are seeking our remedy. Mm-hmm. That's what we need. Mm-hmm. And to find it, you need a strong advocate. You don't need a sellout and a wimp.
And that's why our health care system is.
Yes. It's all about money.
And that's what's behind the criminalization of marijuana.
It's money. Yes, yes. I mean, I saw in the nursing homes.
The whole drug war.
Yes.
Not just marijuana is a prime example and easy to use as an example.
Exactly.
But the whole drug war is just a way to enslave people.
Because the whole nursing
home. The whole drug war.
The only knowledge they had, they couldn't get my mother to swallow. I came in there and brought an acupuncturist mm-hmm. in. That's why the Black Panther got 30 years in mm-hmm. prison, because he probably moved into a hospital that was probably legitimately foreclosed because it was abandoned. They couldn't pay whatever. So there's an empty building. Here you needed to help people. It was such a natural. If they had not locked him up, in no time flat, he could have shown a superior medical system, not just for Black people, for the entire city.
A medical alternative.
Or that works.
That works.
That works. Even
yes.
alternative implies that the thing in place is working. It's not working. Mm-hmm. People are dying.
Mm-hmm. Can I jump in 1 second, since we brought up the drug thing? The Supreme Court overturned prohibition, and when they overturned alcohol prohibition, they said you can't prohibit from the American people, right? Which means I don't care what drug people are doing, you can't prohibit from the people. The whole drug war was a scam just to fill our prisons and enslave people. Mm-hmm. You know,
and to keep the pharmaceutical
I'm not saying that
going.
I advocate people doing heroin, because mm-hmm. heroin, the government addicted all those people. The government pushed heroin. The government pushed cocaine. Noriega was working with Bush, yes. Daddy Bush, Mm-hmm. And that all that whole thing, the Iran-Contra thing, they were trading guns for cocaine, bringing it in and dumping it in the ghettos, mm-hmm. you know? But then they used these bogus drug wars to arrest all the people in the ghetto that they were supplying with drugs. Mm-hmm. You know, it's
still
about slavery.
And to pick up the buildings.
Well, the whole issue of drugs, it was obvious to anyone who could think. And I used to speak around Harlem about it constantly and say, there's no war on drugs, there's a war on us.
Right.
Nothing to do with drugs. I says, understand something. A society that doesn't care about what you eat, a society that would sell you a cigarette that the government has helped to make killer,
right.
because understand,
right.
cigarettes are responsible for more health problems than all of the other drugs combined.
Right.
And this government, they've done that. They don't care about your education. They don't care about your health care. They don't care about hospitals. They care about what you put in your body. Be serious. They do not. And don't let them confuse that. But what they did again was they confused people. They had preachers saying, we need more policemen. They had, you know, the drugs are destroying the society. And I'm saying, wait a minute. The society was always destroyed. It has never been a society. We in the black community have never gotten beyond colony. We are still a colony. And then when they don't want it, they take over your colony. We are just a caretaker on the physical area where a colony that we were existed. We never got to the status of ghetto where we controlled our resources, etc. This is what and understand this whole political thing. So what is the enemy? Education is the enemy.
And that's
truth
where Lynne comes in, because she used to say all of her clients were potential political prisoners.
Yeah.
Because if you have an economic system and the only way out of this vice of poverty and starvation is a good education, and yet one group of people gets that good education for free and another group does not, and it is by design, because there's no way you can tell me any human being is uneducable, having been a teacher for over 40 years. I know this is not true.
Yeah.
Then you are setting these children up to become political prisoners, because the only route for them to survive is to go into a life of crime to make a living. Mm-hmm. This is what drugs is all about.
Yeah, because
it's about making a living.
Right.
And for these preachers and for the Black Congressional Caucus to vote for stronger legislation to incarcerate people who are involved in drugs is duplicitous, and it's perfidious
cowardice.
Why didn't they fight for community control the way they fought the war on drugs? If the preachers who are now marching telling these children to turn in their guns would adopt a public school, you could end most of the guns.
Right.
You could control the gangs. How do I know?
Right.
Every school I've been in, I've been successful with that group of students.
Well, that's the whole idea of due process.
Thank you.
Everything. It's as Lynne says, how do we sum up? What is the problem of America?
Mm-hmm.
What is the quickest way and the most proficient way to sum it up? And I says, tell me. And she says, recognize there is a total loss of morality.
Yeah.
Dealing with anything.
Mm-hmm.
There is no morality.
Right.
It's all gone.
Right.
You talk about the law, and we can talk about the law. There was never a law in America that the system was bound to respect regarding people of a hue of like mine. Herman Wallace, who was dying, he was not guilty. He submitted this, you know, like a
case, his own case.
He was 40 years in solitary?
41, I believe it was.
41.
He
is he dead? Did he die?
No, well, as far as I know,
there's a death watch now.
There's a death watch. He's about to go. But one of the things that you realize when you begin to just casually look at the case, he filed this complaint that he was unjustly incarcerated 39 years ago. You know, like,
he fought his own case.
And so now, 39 years, cancer, dying, 5 minutes before dying, as we say, hey, that's an unjust way. There's no victory. and Herman Wallace getting out of jail.
It's a Pyrrhic victory.
It's nothing, because he's going to be dead. We don't want that type of victory for Lynne Stewart. We don't want 5 minutes before she's ready to die, let her out. Marilyn Buck, 10 days before she's ready to die, let her out. No, that is not a victory.
And that's the tip
we,
of the iceberg.
We, the people, have allowed this system to go on unabated because of color, class.
There are over 70 political prisoners, warriors from the 60s, who over 100, who are reaching this age group. They aged out. They maxed out their time. And
but
under Obama, they were reindicted?
No, they weren't reindicted. They just didn't get out of jail.
They just wouldn't let them out.
The Obama administration did nothing about it. So much, you know, and see, we have to examine that. There's no morality or truth in education. We go back to who is a smart person? Somebody who went to Harvard University. Total nonsense. Who did we have? Kissinger, domino theory. And everybody says, oh, he's the brightest. Let's go to war on the domino theory. And anybody who studied anything about history knew that the domino theory was a fraud for 6,000 years. The Chinese.
What about Greenberg? Is that his name and his economic theory?
Yeah.
What was his name?
No, you're talking about the. Help me here.
The trickle down economy.
The chairman of the Fed.
Yeah.
Come on.
Greenspan.
Pardon me.
Knew everything.
What was his theory? The trickle down?
No. That was it.
That was voodoo.
That was voodoo.
That was another dumb capitalist.
That was voodoo economics. And
Reagan.
No, but under his head of the head of his economic department wrote a book on it, and I have the book because they took it out of print. I got it from
But the point you're making is all these so-called pundits,
bright people, are nothing but scales who huck theories to the people based on their intelligence. And when I heard Obama speak, and he spoke out about black men not taking care of their responsibilities, and it struck me, I says, this man who's supposed to be bright wouldn't pass political science 101. Mm-hmm. Because when I went to college, the first thing I learned in political science was you cannot separate rights and responsibilities. And Obama jumped up and said 10 times, he's going to separate. I don't care about the rights that you haven't had. I will not support the rights. I will not even work for you to have the right to vote. Never mind any of the other rights. And now you're responsible for raising your family. And I'm saying, this guy's a total idiot.
But these 100 people that we are calling political prisoners, they did that. They put their lives on the line. Most of them were black. They stood up and fought for their rights. And his response to them is to keep them in jail, even though now they are dying. So he speaks with two voices. On one hand, black men don't take responsibility. On the other hand, he is incarcerating our warriors, our warrior black men who took responsibility the American way.
Well, one of the things I say, we have avenues of information, but we don't pay attention to them. And I say, one of the, you know, black people look at movies. We go to movies a lot. And me, I look at Westerns. I love the scenery, and I love the whole idea of a Western morality through the barrel of a gun. And now it's like,
it's true. That's
when I'm looking at it, and I say, gee, I'm not the only one. How come nobody else pays attention? And it's in the Western movie, we learn white man him speak with forked tongue.
Yeah.
That's it. I saw that.
Black man is too.
Black man him speak with forked tongue too. When he get in that position. And so I'm saying, and we love the mafia. We love the mob. Mm-hmm. And we look, and everybody must know that if you don't protect your organization, it'll go down. But I says, everybody looks at that, and we act like it's, I don't know what happens between when you cook, as Harvey Shapiro used to say, all of the air is blown out of the people's minds. This is what the propaganda that we get every day, how this affects us. We can see the truth, we can hear the truth, and it doesn't mean anything to us. And this is where Lynne Stewart comes in. When, and I don't want to say this, I guess it'll come back to haunt me.
But then don't say it.
I'm going to say it anyway. I'm
going he likes to,
say
to be haunted.
Because it is the young men who Lynne defended oftentimes, they were accused of a crime. The young guys in the community would say, it ain't over till the fat lady sings. And that was Lynne Stewart representing them in court. And as Lynne Stewart would say, we must educate our children. And when a person gets me as a lawyer, they not only get a good legal defense, but they get some political education. And as the lawyer, I'm going to force them to listen to reality. And I used to look at her and smile when she would, you know, guys would say, well, you know, I didn't do it. And she'd say, how long have you been black? And they would, you know, catch them, you know, and just... white lady is asking me how long I've been black, and she says, you were meant to go to jail the day you were born, and if you didn't understand that, then we have to talk about something.
But I want to go back to something Paula said in the very beginning. She remembered some of the phrases from Ramsey Clark, former Attorney General Ramsey Clark, the fact that when Ramsey went to visit Lynne, you know, suffering with cancer, after being neglected treatment by the government for so long, he came away feeling uplifted. She raised his spirits.
Right.
One of the things, everyone who visits a political prisoner, be it Mamiya, Russell Maroon Schultz, Matula Shakur, Sekou Odinga, any of these men or women, when you visit them in prison, they lift your spirits. I think I told you I teach philosophy. I think you know I have no faith in anybody's religion. I'm waiting for them to practice what they preach.
Me too.
And that goes for all of them, maybe except for the Buddhists. However, how do I know we have a soul? And that's allegedly a religious concept. I'll tell you how I know we have a soul. If you listen to the words of Herman Wallace, since his incarceration, if you listen to the young prisoners coming into that hideous, vicious Nazi death camp, because we don't have prisons anymore, we have death camps now, and all of them testifying how Herman Wallace is the reason they survived, what's the place called in Louisiana?
Angola.
That's how you know we have souls, because Herman Wallace's soul shines. Mamiya's soul shines. They still have faith. They still speak truth to power. They still speak of love, loving their families. They still...
Well, they didn't sell out.
That's right.
They're not conflicted.
That's how you know
they're
that not, humans
they're connected
have a soul.
To their source.
That's how you know.
Yeah, yeah.
That is
well,
how you know.
As Lynne states,
and if there's such a thing as sainthood, these are the people who would be called saints.
Yes.
For
because
sure.
They've given everything.
For sure.
As Lynne says about political prisoners, in the words of Sundiata Okola, is... the greatest faith on this planet is the faith that political prisoners have.
Yes.
That we the people will free them. And I'm saying, wow.
Yes.
That is, and so yes. Every time I think, boy, I'm sick of these meetings, I'm sick of going, you know, to this demo, and I'm sick of going to that demonstration, and I don't want this vigil. And then I think of the greatest faith. Let me go to one more.
Right.
Let me go, you know, let me do some more work. This
and don't forget what Lynne said when she went in. I'm a newcomer on the block.
Oh, yeah.
Free the others. All right? Free them.
Yeah,
they had
I know.
Been there long enough.
I know.
She always says, don't ever mention me without mentioning all the other political prisoners. And this new one, Marie Mason, her story is horrible. All she did was try to free the earth. And they give her 30 years, this woman, for trying to save trees. Well, can we live without trees? Can we live without water? All right? These people are called eco-terrorists.
I think at the basis, you know, when you talk about capitalism, I don't think capitalism's the issue. The issue is monopoly. And monopoly keeps resources away from people. And if people don't have resources, they can't create wealth.
Mm-hmm.
And as a result, we have this illusory society. It's not real wealth. What you were talking about, Lynne came from a police family. They were giving service as policemen. You came from a working family.
Working class.
They did something. When people are so much into the fraud and the swindle, nothing's being produced. Pretty soon, even though they seem to be respectable people in society and they're giving away to
Wall
charities
Street.
And stuff, because their wealth isn't real wealth, but it's based on fraud, it's empty. And as a result, those who are really trying to create wealth, like an honest cop family, because I met many honest cops that know that they're there to protect the Constitution, not the bankers, not special interests, or judges that know that justice should be dispensed in a blind way, not this person's rich,
like
give him the benefit
like that. Like
that
sheriff out west who refused to follow up on foreclosures. He just absolutely refused it. And I think there was another one in Philadelphia did the same thing, refused to serve.
The ticket and the position that she was not going to foreclose on.
Well, of course,
and she lost the election. People didn't vote for her.
She lost.
Well, so they said. I mean, who?
Well, very well put.
So they said.
So they said.
Yeah.
But I didn't see any demonstrations of people in the street protesting, as in when they said that Bush won one election in Florida. People went to the streets and they had the answer. They sent Al Sharpton to have a demonstration and then chill it out. And then when they're higher, when people said, people did go to the streets and say, hey, no, this can't be. But you see, there were no people in the streets to say, hey, we voted for this lady.
And you speak of illusions. That's one of the biggest American illusions, that they have a two-party system.
Right.
I don't know.
Right.
That is one of the biggest myths going. And it's not just America.
I know.
All of the so-called democratic societies in the West, they have figured that game out of Mutt and Jeff.
Right, right.
Bad cop, good cop,
and they're
both cops.
And you know how they do it with the IP address thing? They do it with Mac and PC platform. They confuse you with different platforms. Joe, in our last 10 minutes, could you talk about the jury, the grand jury? Because we were talking about not having a war.
I'd like to do that for another show, but I would like to say on capitalism, because capitalism came up just a minute ago. I think capitalist system is a good system. The flaw in capitalism is they say if you're in this economic group, you're poverty. If you're in this economic group, you're middle class. If you're in this economic group, you're upper middle class, right? And they got a standard between this money and this money is this. Between this money and this money, the flaw in the capitalist system is they should have said, even at $10 million, you're rich, here's your gold watch, retire. You can't make any more. That would have left enough to go around. But now, the capitalist system has gotten to where we got billionaires, and soon we're going to have trillionaires. Now, those billionaires and trillionaires have all the money of the people who could be millionaires.
Well,
there would be enough money to go around.
Or could be productive.
All of that may well be true, but I always say be careful of the words. We have not seen a capitalist system. We have seen capitalist principles practiced behind an imperialist economic
structure.
Right.
And when you start off with free land, nobody talks about the free land, kill genocide, kill the indigenous people here, free that. When they talk about free labor, we'll bring those people from there. When we talk about cheap labor, we'll bring the immigrants
cheap
in.
Resources.
Cheap resources.
The Arabs can't have their oil. The Africans can't have their gold.
And I says, now, where does capitalism, you know, let's look at capitalism for real. Let's have a society. And I says, suppose, you know, that when Columbus got here and said, everybody's in it, you know, like, of course, he couldn't have because he was supported by the corporations, the trading companies to come and steal the money. Mm-hmm. So he couldn't say, hey, we're all in it. Let's divide this up. Let's work hard and you'll work. Mm-hmm. And I always say, I don't care what you call it, but whatever it is, it has to include everybody in it. With an equal shot. Now, how do you do that? It deals with education, understanding, no hidden agendas, etc. We don't have that. We're working towards it. Capitalism, give me a break. Look at this. And somebody had said, we're going to put all those foreigners out. And I says, I agree. Put them out. And I says, the Indians and I are going to get together and put all you white folk out, because my history goes back to 18, and it's traced it back to 1819 in the Delmar Peninsula. So I'm here longer than anybody else. So all you foreign folks, get out of here. We're going to start a society all over.
But let's just start from where we are right now. The top six slave states, I believe it's the United States, England, France, Spain, Portugal, and I'm missing one.
The Netherlands. Sure,
let's just say that we have a little reparations here.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Okay. First, leave. Reparations number one, get out. Take neocolonialist institutions with you. Just go. And second, pay back that phony International World Bank debt that you have been stealing from these countries. They don't owe you a dime. Let's just start there.
Well, no,
and then let capitalism try and work.
No, I want to do another one. Let us stop them from stealing from us from this day forward. Never mind.
Yeah.
No more.
Put all the bankers
no
in
more
jail.
Stuff.
That's how we started
right,
there.
Right.
But so then that's where your law comes in.
Yeah.
That's where your grand jury comes in.
Right.
Can
right.
you compose a grand jury
right.
to indict the bankers? Let's just
yes.
start there.
Yes.
But
yes.
you have to have an
for
army sure. to put them out because they control the army.
But people don't know yet. They
not
don't
just,
really
not
understand.
Not just lock up the bankers, but seize their assets and return it to those who've had it stolen from.
Now, what kind of grand jury is going to do that?
Well, they have, as Harvey Shapiro used to say, all of the air is blown out of the people's minds. They do not understand, because there are many we still have in the minds of the American people the divine right of kings, and they make a king. And they have made the dukes and the counts, the corporations and the wealthy people. How many people are out looking at Prince Somebody's baby? You know, like Prince somebody else's
Prince
marriage.
Williams.
You know, whatever it is. You know, and no, we do it. And so if we don't have that, we have the Kardashian sisters.
Yeah.
There's some women that a lot of people are interested in. Mm-hmm. And she's going out with somebody else, you know, the divine right of kings, dukes, counts, and princes that they make up.
But I think also most Americans think they're going to be trillionaires someday.
Oh,
that is the biggest illusion.
So when we get people's minds going in that direction, we're in trouble.
Ralph.
And so your program here is educational. It's wonderful. You know, please look at it and pick up something and write back.
And don't forget October 8th, Lynne
October
Stewart,
8th,
Tuesday.
Come out and see us again.
6 to 10 p.m.
6 to 10 p.m.
St. Mark's Theater.
St. Mark's Theater on 1st Street. And
I'm really looking forward to it.
1st Avenue. And 8th Street, and meet some more people who will give you something to think about, something to take home with you the rest of the week until you have another exciting program.
Well, I think that's the most important thing, is that we can assemble freely and we can enjoy each other.
Yes.
And boy, did I enjoy that event last May. I'm really looking forward to next
Tuesday.
And I want to say something to all the people out there in television land. Get educated and get active. Mm-hmm. If you, the American people, don't wake up, it's only going to get worse. And if you, the people, wake up, we could have the kind of country that we should have.
If you want to know more about political prisoners, there's the Jericho, as in Joshua fought the Battle of Jericho, the Jericho website. I also suggest you check out the Black Agenda Report, the Black Commentary, and by all means, check out the WBAI archives on any area that you want to learn. And please check out the Rabbit Hole Archives. I assume you have
on the WBAI?
No. Do you have
your own
archives?
Yeah, we have Freedom First Party.
FreedomFirstParty.net.
Yeah, that's where we're putting a lot of our stuff.
Especially when it comes to issues of health.
Yeah.
Because I've learned a lot over the years from your emails concerning health.
Yeah.
I really thank you for that.
Oh, well, it's just the beginning. I mean, we need free speech. We could have so much more of it. I have doctors, you know, I have scientists that are just eager to give knowledge, but they're afraid.
They're afraid.
Because we need kind of warrior types like us to protect the intellectuals, to protect the scientists,
the people that really...
They're wanting so much to share this.
Thank you.
I know doctors that are afraid to tell their patients about marijuana oil, and patients who are afraid of their doctors, and they might be in the same room at the same time, not exchanging this information with each other.
What did Queen Mother Moore used to say? This is a woman in the black community who gave everything. She was a Garveyite. And she used to say to people, some people are going to walk with you to the door. Some people are going to walk to you to the door and go in and walk up the stairs. Some people are going to stop at the door, and some people are going to stop at the top of the stairs, and some people are going to walk all the way and fight with you all the way to the top floor,
right,
where we get freedom.
Yeah.
She says, but whatever you can do, then do that.
Right.
And
right.
The people are afraid. And
right.
It's our job to say to them, well, come with us as far as you can go.
Right.
You know? Well, I'm sorry.
I would like to just skip aside to say, you know, when you talk about health and medicine, and one of the, you know, and learning something from TV, and I don't know, I was watching a program, I don't know what it was, a medical program, and one of the facts that they mentioned is the greatest number of prescriptions surpassing all of the others was Oxycontin. And
wow.
So I said, wait a minute, I have trouble getting my high blood pressure medicine sometimes, right? You didn't go to the doctor on time, and you know what I'm saying? What do you mean I didn't go to the doctor on time? I got high blood pressure. I said, this is what I take. I says, can I sell this stuff on the street? I think I get pays me $6 a month to get this stuff. And I said, so I says, what is this? And this Oxycontin, maybe I'll just put an Oxy something in front of it, and then maybe you'll fill it for me. You know, and so the pharmacist says, oh, Jesus, don't go there. And so I says, is that true? And she says, sadly, you know, yes. And so I says, here we have, you know, this shows the how it's totally messed up.
It's
the economy is totally messed up.
That.
And then we go back to the basic. What did Lynne say? The problem is a lack of morality on any issue.
Right.
Medicine, health,
right.
Law,
right.
You know, property,
right.
Jobs,
right.
How everything. There's no,
right.
This,
right.
It's about
right.
The bottom line is a buck, and no matter what you got to do, do it to get it, and this is where we are.
So what happens when people go down the rabbit hole,
Paula? Right, Paula, tell us about what the rabbit hole.
What happens when they get down to the road? To the rabbit hole.
Well, we're going to find out, aren't we? I've learned so much from my guests, as I have today, and I'm
thank you for having
looking
us.
Forward to Tuesday.
Okay.
I'll bring my
we're
camera.
Happy to have you guys.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
For sure.
Thanks.
Time for you to say, yeah, yeah.
Sorry,
okay.
My hands are so cold.
Thank you, Malik, in
right.
The control room. This
me.
Is Paula Gloria, and thank you for joining me on this episode of Farther Down the Rabbit Hole. Thanks.
Yeah, I like the conclusion. What happens?